Good evening. Well, talking about analysis of univariate data, and we look into various measures of central tendency as well as position. So today we'll talk about two more such measures called as measures of dispersion, or also called as measures of spread or deviation. And later we'll talk about measures of skewness and kurtosis. And if time passes, we'll look into the analysis of bivariate data also. Now, the property of dispersion is also important. So along with the measures of central tendency, we like to obtain what is the scatterness available or exhibited by the data. So you have x values, individual values selected on the variable. And now we look into what called as the distance between the values of x from their particular average, and we can also talk about the average distance. And one such average what we have learned, which is most widely used, is arithmetic mean, which is indicated by x bar for the variable x. And if I could somehow obtain on an average what is the distance between the values of x with respect to their arithmetic mean, then such an average is called as variance. So here, in terms of say measures of spread, we are basically telling you that, I mean, we are observing, I have an x bar value, I have an average here, and I have certain observations like this. So how far and how close the data values are with respect to its particular average. So that essence or that behavior of the spread is captured in one of the measures called as variance. And this is the most widely used measure along with the arithmetic mean. And I can use this measure of variance, or also, you know, in other terms, it is standard deviation. They capture the same behavioral property of scatteredness. We define standard deviation as variance, and you can use these measures if you feel that they are suitable for the variable under your study. That is, you have a variable which is where the magnitude actually represents or reflects the characteristic, or I could say your variable is taken over the interval scale or ratio scale, then the variables are free from the extreme values, then arithmetic mean along with standard deviation are the two measures which are commonly used. Now coming to the other measure. So what exactly is this measure capturing? It is capturing how far your x bar is, you know, from, or how far or how close it is with respect to their measures, with respect to the observations. Now, if you look into the measures, they could be roughly categorized into two cases. The one where you need the measure in terms of the units of measurement of the variable, and sometimes if you want to compare the measures with respect to different distributions, then you need the measures which are free of or not based on the units of measurement. Like say if you have your x represented or measured in terms of centimeters, you have another distribution y which is in terms of kgs, and if you want to see which distribution is, you know, less scattered, which distribution is more scattered, in that case, if you want to make a comparison, you should compute a unit. In this case, where my x is in centimeters, if I have the measures also in centimeters, then there will be a problem in comparing the units. So we try to segregate these measures into two cases, roughly called as absolute measures as well as relative measures. Absolute measures indicate the measure in terms of the exact unit of measurement of the data, and those measures are range. We know about range, defined as highest minus lowest. And we have concept called as quartile deviation, which is based on quartile. So when we say we have some extreme values in the data, instead of looking into those extreme high and low values, I could only deal with the middle 50% of the data. In that case, the range becomes Q3 minus Q1, and that range is called as interquartile range, and half of this interquartile range is called as quartile deviation. So these are some of the measures commonly used, and standard deviation also comes into this picture. Standard deviation is and then sometimes we have what called as the mean deviation or average deviation. These are the various cases. So of this, you should know the concept of quartile deviation. What is quartile deviation? What are the formulas there? And then you will have the problems on standard deviation. One problem will be there in the examination based on standard deviation. And then mean deviation, we'll just look into the theory part of the formula. We'll not look into the problems there. And coming to the relative measures, each of these measures, as said, they carry the same unit of measurement of the variable, like kg, centimeters, or dollars, whatever it may be. And if you want to compare the measures with two different distributions, where the two distributions have different unit of measurements, in that case, I talk about relative measures. And they are basically the coefficients of the measures what we have obtained. So we define, we call it as coefficient. And for the measure range, coefficient of range is indicated by H minus L divided by H plus L. And then for quartile deviation also, we have coefficient. So the basic idea here is you have to cancel out the unit. So when you divide this Q3 minus Q1 by Q3 plus Q1, that produces the coefficient of quartile deviation. So basically, your quartiles are also in the same unit. So when you obtain the quotient in this case, the unit get cancels. Now, one of the commonly used measure of dispersion, which is a relative measure, is called as coefficient of standard deviation. And some cases, it is also called as coefficient of SD. And it is indicated by standard deviation divided by X bar. Now, we simply indicate the standard deviation by a common notation. We use a Greek letter called as sigma. So this is the small letter sigma. We use capital sigma to indicate total. We use small sigma to indicate standard deviation. And the standard deviation is given by the formula square root of sigma x minus x bar whole square divided by n. Now there are two ways of defining the standard deviation. We call one as the population standard deviation and the other one as the sample standard deviation. Now here you have to understand the logic. Now you have a large population of the particular variable from which you are extracting sample values in order to study the population. In that case, if you just want the standard deviation for the particular sample, then we call it as S is equal to square root of sigma x minus x bar whole square divided by N. But if you want to obtain an estimate of population standard deviation, then we indicate that as sigma cap, and that is given by sigma x minus x bar whole square divided by n minus 1. The denominator will change to n minus 1. The reason we also call this denominator of your variance or this as degrees of freedom. So later when we talk about the hypothesis testing, we'll see why this is called as degrees of freedom and why I lose 1 degree of freedom when I'm estimating the population standard deviation. And if you look into the population standard deviation, it is actually given with respect to the population mean with the value n. So this mean is called as indicated by another Greek letter, which is mu, that is called as population mean. And the definition remains the same. It is the total of all the x values divided by n, where you have the size of the population as n. When you have very small population, that is the size of n is very small, in that case you could look into all the values of x of the population. So you know n, you know all the values, you can compute mu. So standard deviation is the square deviations of x from its mean. Since it is population mean, we are indicating it by mu, I can obtain the population value. But in most of the situations, what happens is we have n to be large, or even n is small, the, you know, it is not easy to access all the population items. So in that case, what we do is we pick a sample of n items from the population, and we use this formula in estimating the value of the population standard deviation, and we use x bar is equal to sigma x by n to estimate the mean of the population. So when we look into the inference part of statistics, we'll completely again revise the concepts of mean standard deviation, and we'll look into the estimational methods there. All right, now we just understand the concepts. So we have two types of two types of standard deviation, population standard deviation, as well as estimate of population standard deviation. So if you actually know the value of mu, then you can obtain the population standard deviation. But if you are talking about a sample, so using sample, you are obtaining an answer for the population standard deviation, then that is called as estimation of population standard deviation, given by the formula sigma x minus x bar whole square by n minus 1. If your sample size n is really large, then whether you use n minus 1 or your n, both numerically comes out to be same. So whenever the question says compute standard deviation for a sample, and if you, you know, you have a dilemma in applying this formula or this formula, go ahead and apply any one. So we just give you marks for the, you know, your understanding on standard deviation and the computational steps. Both are standard deviations. So if you have applied either of this formula and obtained the answer, marks will be given. But we apply this if your objective is to comment on the population. We apply this formula if our objective is just to study that particular sample. Now, if you look into the computational procedure of this standard deviation, it requires all the values of x. I mean, x bar has to be subtracted from all the values of x. Then you have to square it. Then you have to sum it and take the average. Then take the square. So subtracting this x bar from every value of x and squaring becomes a tedious job in terms of calculation. So what we have done is we have simplified this x minus x bar whole square by expanding using the formula a minus b whole square. And after applying the properties of mean, we get the formula of standard deviation as sigma x square by n minus x bar square. So if you look into the simplification now, so it just tells, instead of doing x minus x bar whole square, compute your x bar, take the square of that, obtain the total of x square, and obtain the mean of that, and obtain the difference and take the square root, you will get the standard deviation. So I said when your n is very large, your s and sigma comes to be very much close to each other. So if you feel that this is not easy, but the formula what we have in the prescribed textbook is easier, you can go ahead with this. And as said, for larger case of n, whether it is n or n minus 1, both will give you almost the same numerical value. So this is about standard deviation. Now, once you compute the standard deviation for the data, divide your standard deviation by x bar, then that is called as coefficient of standard deviation. So if you see your standard deviation, though you are squaring, the last step you will take the square root. So the unit of the x is carried along with your sigma. So that unit get cancels, and coefficient of SD is a unit free measure. Now, if you could express this coefficient in terms of percentage so that the comparison becomes very easy, then that is called as coefficient of variation, abbreviated as CV. And this is the most widely used measure of dispersion along with your mean and standard deviation to conclude the measures of central tendency and dispersional properties observed in the data. So CV answers the question, what percent of X bar is our standard deviation? So that is answered by this C. Now these are the formulas for your raw data, that is when you have only the values of X, but when you have the frequencies given to you, then you can compute the standard deviation as sigma f into x minus x bar whole square divided by sigma f, or that could be further simplified as s is equal to square root of sigma fx square by sigma f minus your x bar square. And in case of your frequency data, we know that mean is given by the formula x bar is equal to sigma fx divided by f, and this concept is sigma f x square, which is the total of f into x square. So I have to compute the column f into x square as you did the total of fx in the case of mean. So these are the most commonly used. So you should have a deeper knowledge on mean, standard deviation and CV. And when it comes to your examination, so at least one problem will be there, one numerical problem on the computation of mean, standard deviation as well as CV. It could be for a frequency distribution or it could be for a raw data. So I've shared two exercises with you. So I'll look into one or two problems of that, and you can take the remaining as homework and try to solve those cases. Now, another measure of the dispersion is called as mean or average deviation. And this particular tool or technology has much of the disadvantages compared to the standard deviation. So we rarely use this, but it has its own special application, because whenever we have, say, extreme value in the data, then we say the application of arithmetic mean or standard deviation is not at all possible. So in that case, you could talk about the measures like mean deviation. Why is it called as mean deviation? So I said in the last class, if you talk about total divided by n, the concept is called as mean. So you can have total of x, total of fx, or any other quantity. So here the quantity what we are looking is modulus of, two straight lines indicate modulus of x minus any particular average. So this average could be geometric mean, harmonic mean, or it could be simply arithmetic mean, median, or mode. And as you take different average, the definition also slightly changes. I mean the notation changes. So if you are using x bar as the average, then mean deviation is defined as the total of modulus of the differences of x from its x bar and the average of that. If you are using median, then mean deviation from median is given by summation x minus m divided by n. If you use mode as the average, then it is summation mod x minus n by n. So I said, you need not worry about much of these cases. So you might be, you know, at the most will ask, define the measures of dispersion. Why do we need them? What are the basic categories of measures of dispersion? So you just have a look into the definitions of measures of dispersion, their broad categories, which are absolute measures and relative measures, and then have a deeper knowledge on standard deviation, its formula, calculation of standard deviation, CV, and how to make decision based on the observed values of mean, standard deviation, as well as coefficient of variation. Now coming to why do we need these measures when we already have mean, median, mode. So as said, certain data are such that our objective will be, you know, comparing them, concluding or selecting which is a good distribution, so that, you know, suitable measures later could be taken. Say, for example, as a teacher, I would wish in which particular group the marks is low, in which particular group of students marks is high, how the averages are. So based on that, I could, you know, take a decision of taking some special classes or revision classes, or making them solve some question papers so that the lower category can also come to the average or the above average category. So similarly, so basic idea here is you have two distributions, distribution one, distribution two. You have to compare them and select the one which is a good distribution. So in that case, you could just look into the values of your mean. So I have distribution one as variable x, distribution two with variable y. So if I say I have x bar greater than y bar, I could say this is a good distribution in terms of average. So if you're talking about purchasing the teams or IPL teams where you want to just look into the scores, then you can just go ahead with this. But on the other hand, x bar greater than y bar. So just by, you know, making this one just by comparing x bar and y bar may be, you know, not that useful, because this x bar at certain times gets influenced by the x mean values. Now, when I look into the scores of cricket players or any other particular, you know, game, then I could have as low score as zero. And at certain cases, I could have high scores like 98, 126 also. So though there is presence of x mean values, I cannot omit them because they contribute some information regarding the decision, you know, what I make on the case of the population. So I need additional measures other than x bar in order to make a better decision. So I look into what is the dispersion, what is the spread of the data. So how this x bar is from each and every value, what is the distance between that. So standard deviation captures that. And if you want to make a unitary comparison, you can compute the value of CV and you can select the distribution with less CV. So lesser the value of CV, more consistent the distribution. So you have two sets of data. Say you have blood pressures of male of a certain set of patients, blood pressures of female of a certain set of patients. So you want to see where the average is closer to the a normal blood pressure of say around 80 or 120. So average will help you in deciding that. And you want to see in which set of patients the blood group or the blood pressure is, you know, somewhat uniform or consistent. Or if you are making groups based on their, you know, physical activities, like they do meditations or yoga, they do exercise. So several such experimental groups can be created and you can observe the values of mean, standard deviation, CV, and you can see what is the activity which is leading to less consistent in the scores. And you could generalize that and you could say yoga reduces blood pressure or exercise reduces the sugar level, and certain, you know, decision or generalization statements could be easily done. Now, along with these measures of central tendency, position and dispersion, sometimes we talk about measures of skewness and kurtosis. Now, the skewness and kurtosis is another way to check whether the data is normality. So as said, the normality assumption has to be validated in order to process into the next step of, you know, doing estimations on the population and generalizing the results on the population. So one such measure which is available other than the graphical procedures of histogram and QQ plot, the skewness and kurtosis. So we are basically studying the shape of the distribution. So we have the frequency distribution from which we can obtain the frequency curve. So frequency curve is simply obtained by taking your variable on the x-axis and frequency on the y-axis. So you get a set of points. So join the set of points using a smooth freehand curve that will produce their respective frequency curve. And if you look into the frequency curve of various distributions, you can broadly categorize them into two cases. Roughly, if not very much, you know, accurate, you can have the curves closer to this shape. This is the shape of a distribution called as normal distribution. So if you are observing the shape of the curve to be like this, we call such curves or such distributions as normal distribution. And we could say the assumption of assuming the variable to follow a normal distribution is satisfied. Or certain cases, you could have the distributions like this. So where it is not completely symmetric, but we have very high values observed in the data. So which is, you know, producing the right tail of the distribution to stretch it. So we are observing a stretch in the right tail. So the skewness here, we say the data is not symmetric. So if the data is not symmetric, we call such curves to be skewed curves. So the simple definition of skewness is asymmetry of the distribution or non-symmetry of the distribution. So this is called as a symmetric distribution. The right half, if you cut the curve in the middle, the right half will be the mirror image. One is the mirror image of the other. And though we have to actually draw the curve in order to see whether the distribution is symmetric, no, your measures of central tendency will help you in deciding whether the distribution is skewed or not. So if you compute the measures of mean, median, and mode for a distribution, and if you observe that they are very much equal, or in most of the practical cases, exact equality cannot be achieved, but roughly they will be very much close to each other. In that case, I could say the distribution is symmetric, and I could easily assume that the distribution follow normal distribution. The next case is where the values are, you know, not same as the values shared by the other measures. So I have x bar a different, m and z are taking completely different values, but the values are such that I have the value of mode as the largest. Somewhere here I'll have median, and mean will be the very low because we are looking into the direction of x-axis here. So high value is mean, low value is median. But when you look into the frequency, you will have frequency of mode. Sorry, I had some visitors. So we are talking about a distribution which is not symmetric. And there could be various types of asymmetric distributions. So again, they are broadly categorized into two cases, right skewed distribution. So when I say right skewed distribution, the right tail will be stretched longer compared to the left tail. So this is the left tail, this is the right tail. So what we observe from this graph is that if you want to tell that your distribution is right skewed, then you should have much larger observations. I mean, the magnitude of the values will be very high, and you will have fewer values with low magnitude, which produces high mean as well as low mode. So that is the case. So here you will have Z to be lesser than X bar. So for any distribution, if you observe X bar is larger than Z, then that indicates a right skewed distribution. Now, if the distribution is such that my left tail is stretched longer than the right tail, then I could have a case where my distribution curve looks like this. So here also the peak is observed here, and we know that the peak, the concentration of the values is always around the mode. So that produces mode. So somewhere in the middle, you'll have median. And in this case, the value of arithmetic mean will be low. So if you numerically observe that X bar is Z, then that is indicating that left part of the curve is stretched longer than the right part, and the distribution is called as left skewness. So by this time, you know, we are, you know, somewhat simplifying this property of skewness only based on the measure of central tendency, which are X bar and Z. So case one, we had x bar equal to z for a symmetric distribution. Case 2, we have x bar greater than z for a symmetric distribution. Case 3, I have x bar less than z. So just by observing the numerical value, I could compute the measure of skewness. Now, skew is identified, but to what extent the skew is? How can I quantify this property of skewness using a measure? And a person called Carl Pearson, he observed that. So he basically made this observation, the property of skewness based on x bar and z, and he gave a formula to compute the skewness by just using mean and mode, and that measure is called as Carl Pearson skewness, and it is defined as x bar minus z. Now, if you look into the values of x bar minus z in each of the situation, in the first case, x bar is equal to z. So when you do x bar minus z, you will get the value as 0. So any skewness based on x bar and z, that is, if your x bar minus z equal to 0, then we can say the distribution to be symmetric distribution. Now, case 2, where I have right skew distribution, I have x bar is larger than z. Now, since x bar is larger than z, when I do x bar minus z, I will get an answer which is greater than 0. So we will numerically observe a positive value for x bar minus z. Therefore, the skewness is called as positive skewness. So the other way to define the right skewness is positive skewness, because numerically we observe the measure of skewness to be greater than 0. In this case, we have x bar as a value less than z. So when I do x bar minus z, lesser value minus larger value produces a negative number, negative value. So we call such skewness as negative skewness. So the left skewness is also called as negative skewness. Now this measure is completely based on measure of central tendency, mode, as well as your mean. But if you look into the behavioral property of mode, mode is a measure such that sometimes it doesn't exist. Sometimes there are multiple values taken by mode. In that situation, you can replace your mode by the formula 3 median minus 2 mean. And this was also suggested by Carl Pearson. So he conducted many experimental trials by observing the data, and he came up with such relation. This is called as empirical relation between mean, median, and mode. And this can be used as the formula of mode whenever you are talking about the distribution where mode doesn't exist. So just by looking into the data, you feel that there is no repeated number, or you have the data such that there are multiple high frequencies. In that case, we say multiple mode exists or no mode exists. In that case, you compute the value of median, you compute the value of mean, substitute them here, obtain the value of mode, and use that value of mode in estimating the skewness. Or the other cases that you can just substitute the formula of your mode here, and you can simply simplify this measure of skewness. Instead of using x bar minus z, you can just obtain it in terms of median as well as mean, and that is 3 times of your x bar minus m. So what is happening here is, so I said, if you don't have mode from the data, you compute x bar, you compute m, compute z, and then visit this. Or the other way is, instead of doing obtaining the value of z, I could skip that step. I could substitute the formula of z as 3 median minus 2 mean here. And when I simplify the formula, I get the Carl Pearson skewness as x bar minus median and 3 times of that. So we'll use this when mode is ill-defined. So mode beta gela, you can just look into the value of median, obtain the difference of median and x bar multiply by 3, then you can talk about skewness. But we know that x bar is affected by extreme values. So if you have less or no extreme values in the data, these methods, these formula produces the accurate result regarding the skewness of the data. But if you have extreme value in the data, x bar gets affected. In all those cases, you will observe x bar value to be very high, and this formula always leads to the conclusion that the distribution is positively skewed. So we need a measure where I have extreme values in the data, but yet I have to check whether my distribution is symmetric, but I am in a situation where I cannot use x bar as well as z. In that case, we talk about another type of skewness given by the person called as Bowley. And he said, since your quartiles are not affected by the values, that is extreme values, use the quartiles, all the three quartiles, upper, lower, and middle quartile, Q1, Q2, Q3. And he said Q3 plus Q1 minus 2, Q2 could be suitable in order to study the skewness. And the conclusions are also similar. So if you have equal to zero, positively skewed, symmetric, greater than zero, positively skewed, less than zero, negatively skewed. So this is how we conclude. But these two measures are always, they come along with the same unit of measurement. X, the yen unit is there, kg, rupees, dollars, etc. The same carries. So if you want to compare the skewness of two distribution, so you have selected two data sets for your, you know, research. Now your question is which data set I have to select. So you compute all the measures of central tendency, all the values like this, and see in which case the skewness is very low. So lower the skewness, that is, if you look into lower values of skewness, more symmetric the data will be. So skewness is less indicates that your X bar is closer to Z, or your Q2 is closer to, equally closer to Q1 and Q3. In that case, your distribution becomes more and more symmetrical, and that set can be selected for the research work. And moreover, if two distributions are completely different in terms of unit of measurements, in order to compare them without the units of measurement, you can compute what called as coefficient of skewness. And for Carl Pearson May method, it is given by x bar minus z divided by sigma, or x bar 3 into x bar minus mu divided by median divided by standard deviation. So if you divide by standard deviation, the unit get cancelled. And for Bowles coefficient, you can divide the value of skewness by the difference of the upper and lower limit, so that the unit get cancels and you will get a unit free measure. Okay, so when it comes to the examination, it is enough if you have the knowledge of skewness and various measures of skewness, how the skewness are classified based on measure of dispersion, central tendency, and measures of position, why we need two different measures, what are the situations where I can apply this formula or this formula, and what is the difference between skewness and coefficient of skewness, why do we need those two cases. So such knowledge is sufficient, and you will have a theory question on this. What is skewness? Name the distributions, types of distribution based on skewness. So if we talk about symmetric distribution, left skew distribution, right skew distribution, what are the properties of x bar, z, and m for each of those cases? Then how do you quantify the skewness based on these three measures? What would you do when you don't have your mode available in the data? And such cases could be just theoretically concluded. So this is about the measure or property called as the skewness. Now, along with this, so only the symmetricity is not sufficient, because our normal distribution is such that it is symmetric, as well as if you look into the peak, it is somewhat moderate. It is neither too sharp nor too flat. Neither too sharp nor too flat. So I should have a distribution curve such that it follows normal. Now the cases, you know, if you just look into this x bar z, you could have a case where your x bar is equal to z, or your Q3 plus Q1 is very much close to